Okay, so welcome everyone to the eighth and previous to last lecture of this course. Actually, I will start with content from the previous lecture that I didn't have time to explain, which was experiments on the Haralasas equality. So I go back slightly on closed equilibrium conditions, and this is a bit of a summary. So this is a factorization dissipation relation. When you have a system, for example, a colloid in equilibrium, and you weakly perturb it, for example, applying a sinusoidal weak force on the colloid, the response in this under this weak perturbation and the fluctuations without the perturbation are related by this quantity, as I shown in this, you can read also in this review that I put in the bottom. Well, however, when, for example, you are in a bacterial bath, so the original system is not an equilibrium system. This, when you perturb it weakly, the response is not related to the fluctuations in the way is given by the fluctuation dissipation relation. So this is Brock. And this has been shown, for example, in microrheology experiments with biological systems. For example, in an actomyosin cortex, you put a colloid, you measure the correlation function, you do the free transform, and then you do the same, but you have the response, you get the response function from these trajectories, and you will find that this, which has also been done, okay, this is from the 2007, this was done, for instance, with a sinusoidal force in the group of Christoph Schmidt, this is a paper in Science, you will find that out of equilibrium, so biological systems are in general out of equilibrium, and the response and the fluctuation do not obey fluctuation dissipation relation. As you show in the figure on the right, you see that the correlation function is with times omega is on top of the response. So this is really a clear experimental biological manifestation of non-equilibrium, which has been shown in different systems, not only in actomyosin gels like this one, but also in living oocytes. This is an experiment done in France, I believe, a few years ago. Also in an oocyte, you have a non-equilibrium steady state, so that there is energy consumption, but by, for example, molecular motors that are moving the gel, you can also do response experiments here and drag a colloid and measure the response and compare with the fluctuations and see that, again, this spectrum of the correlations and the response are not on top of each other, and there is a manifestation of activity in biological systems. In particular, these two nice papers, they also used this equality from Harada-Sasa to compute the entropy reproduction in the surrounding medium, because the entropy reproduction that you get from Harada-Sasa equality is the one of the unperturbed system. So in this situation will be, you have a particle in an active gel, so the active gel is spending energy, and you'd like to understand how much energy is dissipated in this in maintaining the system alive. And here they get, for example, you see in the figure in the bottom right, 10 to the 2 kVTs. So you can this relate to how many motors do you have in the gel, etc. We did this also with hair bundles. These are very tiny cells in the ear of the bullfrog, and we get also similar results, up to thousands of kVTs per second. And another interesting model is in red blood cells. So you know very well what is a red blood cell, and what you may not know so well is that red blood cells fluctuate and the membrane is shaking all the time. This is called membrane flickering, and it was thought for many, many years that this flickering is an equilibrium process. But this was because of thermal fluctuations near the red blood cell that is shaking the membrane. However, you can do a beautiful experiment, like pick a red blood cell with colloids and perturb one of the colloids and apply a force, as you see on the top left in my slides, and measure the fluctuations without this periodic force and the response to the small periodic force. And you can see in the figure in the bottom that when the red blood cell is alive, fluctuational response do not match, and there is a signature of life and entropy production here. So it is a result that is being applied in many biological systems, and that it's really informative and it can help to quantify energetics of living matter. All right, so okay, if there's any question, please let me know. If not, I'll go ahead and start with another topic, which is somehow related, but it's irreversibility and dissipation. So now, what I'll try to explain is what happens if you are not close to equilibrium, but you are arbitrarily far from equilibrium. Of course, I cannot explain what is going on fully, but I can give you some celebrated and useful results about this topic. Okay, so I will use my own handwritten notes. So if you don't understand anything, please ask. So this is the question: what can we say about small systems arbitrarily far away from equilibrium? There are different paradigmatic models which I went through my course. One is, for instance, you have a particle in a potential and you modulate the potential as a function of time. Like, for instance, you have a periodic potential with as a period L, and you are changing the phase as a function of time like this. So this will be the potential time zero. This will be the potential at a later time. This way you're doing work, and the trajectories are also irreversible. So dissipation, we know since a long time, as a signature in irreversibility. Another way, it's having a non-equilibrium stationary state. So the potential is fixed, but you have an external force pushing the particle. You can have a ring, and you are pushing the particle. Or you can have more complicated, like, for example, you have two thermal baths in contact, and 1 degree of freedom, for example, the X degree of freedom of the particle is at the cold temperature, and the Y is at a hot temperature. This you can build in an experiment, and this is also an equilibrium state. All right. So there are quantities that are key in stationary states. One is, for instance, the net velocity. So you make many simulations, or you look at many experiments at X of t, at the position of a particle, and you measure the average slope. This will be the net velocity, which will reflect on also a net velocity for the entropy production. So this will be called the rate of entropy production. I call it sigma sometimes. Until now, until stochastic thermodynamics, there was not a very clear understanding on how this sigma relates to irreversibility of trajectories. For instance, the best insights were from Prigogine on Sager, etc., which developed the linear response theory. So they showed close to equilibrium, you can write the entropy production as a sum of forces times fluxes. Okay, for example, if you have a force could be a gradient of concentration, this will generate a particle current. So the current times the concentration gradient will be always positive in this case when you have one flux. When you have many fluxes, it will be a combination. You will have this type of relation. Sorry, I have a call here. I have to switch off this. Right. So it, close to equilibrium, fluxes and forces are related linearly. So you can say that F is on Sager coefficient times the flux. And then this makes that the entropy production becomes a bilinear form in the fluxes. And this makes that the entropy production can be shown to be positive because of this on Sager reciprocity relations. Okay. However, this is from the previous century. So what do we do in the 21st century with thermodynamics? How can we relate irreversibility and dissipation quantitatively in non-equilibrium systems? We know something about this because I already introduced something in my course. And we know that entropy production, we know that this stochastic entropy production associated to a single trajectory can be written like this. Boltzmann constant, logarithm of the probability for a trajectory divided by the probability in the time reverse process of the time reverse trajectory. I explained you that when you average this over many trajectories, you get a Kullback-Leibler divergence between the probability to see a trajectory and the probability to see the time reversal in the time reverse process. This from information theory, we know it's always positive. It is zero if and only if the two measures are the same. So if and only if the process and the time reversal have the same probability for all the trajectories. This only happens in one case, which is in equilibrium. You have an equilibrium system, these two distributions are, path probabilities are equal for all trajectories. For example, in Brownian motion in a potential, you can show this very easily. What does this say for irreversibility and dissipation? It says the following: you take this and divide by Kp, and this is a quantity that is physical. So this can be the heat over the temperature. It can be the sum of the heat fluxes to different baths divided by the temperature. It could be the work minus the free energy. Depending on the system, you will have a different expression, different quantity. It is physics. However, on the right side, there is only statistics. This is just taking trajectories and calculating probabilities. This is a very big insight because it is relating thermodynamics with just data analysis, just data, just information. And this is very useful for experiments because, for instance, you can go to a biological system, know very little about it, get one variable, and measure the reversibility for one variable, and then with this, you will get an information about the entropy price. Okay, sorry, I'm getting an annoying call here. And sorry. Okay, I have to continue. Okay, so this is, as I said, a connection between thermodynamics and irreversibility. And so a very big insight was, okay, the result I give you now was general, was for all types of stochastic process. But what we can do is to do a particular case in which we will assume the system is isolated. So as I said, until now, I was telling you I have a system, it has trajectories, and it's in a thermal bath. Okay. Now I will say, imagine if this thermal bath is at a fixed temperature, imagine if now I can see all the molecules of the system and all the molecules of the bath. This super system, it's an isolated system described by a Hamiltonian. And I can think about the following: the probability for an entire trajectory of the system and bath. Imagine I can measure all of them, because this is a deterministic, is a Hamiltonian system, is deterministic. This is equal to the probability to see one snapshot. So if you know in a Hamiltonian system, you know the initial state, you know the final state, and you know all the trajectory. So the probability for an entire trajectory, system and bath variables, position and momenta, is the same as the probability of all the molecules of the bath, positions and momenta at one snapshot in time. So this is like making one photograph of all the degrees of freedom of the system. By the way, this that I'm explaining is in a very beautiful paper. It's called Irreversibility, the Phase-Space Perspective by Kawai, Parrondo, and Vandenbroek in PRL 2007. This was a paper finished before I started my PhD thesis after this paper, which is very inspirational for me. All right, so this is the probability to have the positions and the, so this is the probability to see a given snapshot of all the bath and system molecules. What happens in the time reversal? So the probability for a time reverse trajectory will be related to the probability of a snapshot in the backward dynamics. So this will be the position of all the molecules at time tau minus t minus the momentum. Be careful here, because when you time reverse the trajectory, if you see, for example, a bank of fish moving, when they move backwards, they are reversing the velocity. They change the velocity. So that's why there's a minus here and tau minus t. So this is the forward process, a trajectory. And in the backward, we flip the momentum and we go like this. Okay. And we are comparing the same time in the drive. So we are doing a snapshot. For example, if you have a process from time 0 to time 10, we do a snapshot at time 3 in the forward and at time 7 in the backward. This is what we do. So this paper, they show that this is the only information you need. Well, it's not the only, because it's all the molecules or all the momenta position at the snapshot. This is the only thing you need to get the dissipation. You can prove that you have the same information in one snapshot of all the molecules than in the full trajectory of the system. So you can reveal the entropy production from a single snapshot that has all the information. So this snapshot has the information of bug and system. Now, what you can also show is you can apply the chain rule for the callback library methods. This means that knowing one variable has less information than knowing two. Okay, so if here you don't see all the bath molecules, all the momentum, etc., you only see one degree of freedom, what you get is an inequality, because this full Kullback-Leibler is greater or equal than the Kullback-Leibler with one degree of freedom. So in general, when you do an experiment, when you take data from a lab, you won't have all the molecules. If you want to estimate entropy reduction from one snapshot, you will have this, and this will be a lower bound. This is something we very important in stochastic thermodynamics. Most of the results we have in stochastic thermodynamics are bounds. So we do inequalities. We say there is an entropy reduction of at least this quantity. Okay, you can, please, is there a question?
Yes, excuse me. I didn't get one point. So before you said that we're dealing with Hamiltonian systems, and we're considering QMP as labels for the trajectory of the whole system, so bath plus system.
Yes.
So how do we, why do we treat them as probabilities? I don't see that, because if we're following the entire system, shouldn't it be deterministic? I'm not getting
it. Yeah, actually, okay. Here I wasn't clear enough, because this, okay, what they prove in this paper is these are the system variables, not the bath variables, okay? System variables,
okay,
Q and P. So they still have probabilities, because they are described by a Boltzmann distribution, e to the minus beta times the energy. Okay, so here actually I was not so clear, but this should be all the variables of the system. Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, I was mistaken in this. So you have system variables. If you can measure all of them, then you can track entropy reduction fully. If you measure only a few of them, you can only get lower bounds. And this is the most common scenario in experiments and in stochastic thermodynamics in general. Okay. So going back to stochastic systems, so let me just say the general formula, which was in terms of probabilities of trajectories and time reversals. Now I'm not saying it's isolated. We just have the system, which is in a thermal bath, and the system has fluctuations. When you apply this equality to, for example, 2D stochastic process, imagine you have a process in two dimensions, which has currents, then you will have a probability, joint probability for the trajectory in X and in Y. So you have 2 degrees of freedom, which follow trajectories. This will be a quantity that, of course, will be greater or equal than doing the same thing only with X. And an important issue is this X informative at all? So it could be that even having one variable tells you nothing. Could be. And here is here is an example. Imagine you have this model, X dot equals to noise, and y dot equals to cos x plus omega t plus noise. So this is a 2D system that has currents, because this is time-dependent driving. And you see that the degree of freedom x is a Brownian motion, so it's equilibrium, whereas the degree of freedom y is non-equilibrium. If you compute the Kullback library of trajectories for x, you get zero. It is purely reversible when you only look at the x degree of freedom. If you look at y, it is positive, because it is irreversible in y. So of course, these inequalities work, but it can mean maybe you take a degree of freedom that gives you zero entropy reduction. So you have to be careful and take this in a realistic way, in the sense that maybe you find a variable that contains no information about entropy reduction. These are equilibrium variables. This is what happens actually, what I was telling you before about the bath and the system. The bath is in equilibrium. So these variables do not contribute to the entropy reduction. That's why I told you at the end, you don't have to take into account in the final result, okay? So if you coarse grain, and you measure irreversibility with equilibrium variables, that will give you zero. And you will say the entropy production is greater than zero. Fine, the second law. But that doesn't give you anything new from stochastic thermodynamics. So you need to track variables that are non-equilibrium variables. And in particular, there are some variables that are better than others, but this is a very long topic of research, actually. Okay, so let me continue. And the next thing that I will try to explain is how can you estimate dissipation from single trajectories? So as I said, well, you can look, for example, at one paper we did in 2012 in PRE with Juan Parrondo. The setup will be as follows. You have a physical system. This physical system is dissipating heat. There is entropy production. And out of it, you just get data. So you don't really know what the physical system, what the equations are, but you just get the data and you analyze the data. Okay. For people of you who are fans of data science, maybe you would like this problem. Okay, so you get the data, and I'd like to know from this data, what can I say about the entropy production of the system without knowing much? Okay. A good one thing you can do is to infer the model and then measure the entropy production of the model. But back then in 2010, we were not using any machine learning, nothing. Just we wanted to, from pure stochastic thermodynamics principles, say something about the entropy production of the system that produces this data. All right, so a simple example is a Markov process. Markov process is a process which is jumping between different states, and we will assume it's non-equilibrium at steady state. So we will get, for instance, this type of trajectory, and one can think of the entropy production per unit time. Or you can also think about, and this we did a lot of research about this, is entropy production per jump. So every time there is a jump, there is an entropy production, and I will only read jumps in my trajectory. Some of the results I will show you are for this quantity, which is the entropy production per step. So every time you are here, you don't count it. You just see this, then it happened this, then it happened this, and so on. Okay, I hope, so we don't take into account the waiting times. But the waiting times recently has been shown, they also contribute to entropy production. Okay, so here is an exact calculation of the entropy production for a Markov chain. Imagine a Markov chain, you have a few states, and you wonder what is the probability. Okay, this will be the Kullback-Leibler probability for a full trajectory, which is here, and probability for a time reverse trajectory. What is the probability for trajectory in a Markov chain? It's simple. It's the product of initial and then transition probabilities. This is in the forward sequence, and this is in the backward sequence. So when you continue to do this calculation, okay, I'm interested in the entropy production per unit time, so I have to divide by n, which is the number of data, and take the limit when n goes to infinity. This is what is coming actually from this will be total entropy, but now I'm going to try to do the entropy production per unit time or per step, which is this divided by time when time goes to infinity. Okay, so I try to calculate this, and now I realize that I have x2, x1, x2, xn, there will be x3, x2, x2, x3. So there is always the pairs are coming, and there is AB and BA in the denominator. So you can write all this sum. You can break it in one part that is equal to zero. You can show very easily. And n minus one steps that contain p of x2 given x1 divided by p x1 given x2. So when you have a Markov chain, the irreversibility, which is what I'm showing on the right, it depends only on transition probabilities. So you just need to know probabilities of jumps, which is this. Okay. So all in all this complicated formula became just this formula, which you can show that it is just depending on the probability of seeing first A and then B. That's it. If you have a trajectory of jumps and you just compute the histogram, or how many times do I see jumps 1 to 2, 2 to 3, and 3 to 1, and all combinations, this Kullback-Leibler is just comparing all combinations of transition probabilities. That's it. That's the only information needed to know the entropy production in a Markov process, just jump probabilities. Okay, So with a single degree of freedom, if this is my full process, so I just have a Markov chain and I know there is no, this is all the description of the system, we show that you can compute this very easily, this D2, which is irreversibility at with words of length 2. And this is very nicely being equal to the entropy reproduction. This is here the blue and the black. You can also go at higher orders and measure the probabilities of triplets, mu, nu, and sigma, probability of x1, x2, x3, divided by probability of x3, x2, x1. And this is equally good when you have a Markov chain. And of course, when there is a lot of irreversibility, this starts to have statistics, lack of statistical problems. So it's very difficult to sample all these triplets when you are very irreversible. And you can find this in our this PRL 10 years ago, or 11 already. Okay. What is more interesting me for you is what happens when there's hidden information. So imagine this is your Markov chain. And now let's say, for example, you cannot resolve these two states. This is equivalent of building, so this will be the underlying dynamics, which is Markovian. And this is the observed dynamics, which is non-Markovian. This is called often a hidden Markov chain. Here, the problem is more difficult. And what turns out is that you need more than statistics of jumps to capture the entropy production of the original system. In particular, we show that, for example, if the new data is fourth order Markov, you need to go up to fourth words of length 4, which is intuitive, but we can prove this by doing this analysis as before mathematically. So typically, when you have a hidden Markov chain, you will compute this D sub k's, which are irreversibilities of words of length k, and see that it increases up to a level. And when you saturate this this growth, this will tell you the degree of Markovianity of your system, in a way. But in principle, this is a bit of brute force, so you have to do a lot of histograms, and it's complicated. We can still reveal interesting things. And this is what I'm trying to explain to you in the last minutes. So for example, this is related to this problem that, I don't know if there is volume. Imagine there is a car and it's trying to start the engine, and you can only see the position of the car. So the car is fluctuating, it's going back and forth. But you know that there's dissipation because there is friction of the wheels with the ground, no? However, there is this bush that doesn't let you see all the information of the process. So in particular, you know there is heat, there is a fluctuating trajectory, and you are missing something that is, okay, there is current in the wheels. So the wheels are doing currents, but you cannot see because you can only have access to partial information, okay? This is a typical situation in biology. Of course, this is just a bit of a joke, it's just a graphical illustration, but in biology, this happens a lot. You can see a molecular motor that is dissipating. You don't see the dissipation, but sometimes the motor is not moving at a very fast speed. So it's difficult to guess if this is active or not. In particular, this is a very nice model you can do. It's a flashing ratchet. So you have a particle that is jumping. There's a potential, so it's diffusing here and like this and so on. And this potential is switched on and off at the rate R. So there is a resetting of the potential from a piecewise, like here, to flat, which is a diffusion. When you have this, I'm sorry, because it's tilted, if you have it straight, this will generate a current in this direction. But you can apply an external force to this system and compensate the current of the ratchet with an external force and reach a situation where there is no net motion in X, but still there are loops happening and still there is dissipation. And actually you can see, well, this is from a long time ago, but you can do these trajectories and they are very simple. The nice thing of this model is it's very illustrative. So you see that at a stall force, there is no current, and the irreversibility in words of length 2 is 0. So you go equally likely left to right than right to left. However, there is end-to-end production. So how can we see end-to-end production in a time series that has no currents? This, in principle, is very counterintuitive, but we can do it by just looking at D3. D3 is just the callback ladder with information of triplets. For example, of seeing 1, 2, and 0, and seeing 0, 2, 1. That, in the case there is no current, it reveals irreversibility enough to say that this is an active system and there is entropy production. So this is a big improvement. You see, we increase by 4 or 5 orders of magnitude with D3, and adding more data of longer words, of more correlations, gets you closer to the entropy production aspect. But of course, when you do D9, for example, the data becomes to be scarce. You have 3 states, but words of level 9 become very unlikely to see some of them. Okay, so this is useful. And okay, I just finished with giving you 3 references. Okay, this is an application we did to experimental data with the bullfrog. This is also a very nice paper. I highly recommend you to read, because it discusses symmetries and how to detect the arrow of time or the irreversibility in correlation functions. And you know, the correlation function is even on the time reversal, but in this paper from the, I think it's the 86 or so, they said you have to look at correlations of x at time t plus tau, and x at time t plus 2 tau or 3 tau. So you need 3 time correlations to reveal irreversibility. This is was already explained in this paper in the 86. So now we are doing a revival of some of the results in a different way. And also for the mouse here, but this is a very nice recent paper as well, where they include also the effect of the waiting times in the trajectory. So what I showed you until now was entropy production per jump, but you can extend the theory to entropy production per unit time by also looking at the irreversibilities in the waiting times, which is highly non-trivial as well. And I think this is it from my side. I think it was much faster than what I expected, but I'm open to questions or doubts or anything. There's a question saying, so you are going to hire order decay to take into account non-Markovian. Yes, exactly. When a system is non-Markovian, D3 is not equal to D2. And the more, I think I can share this with you. Share screen. Very good question. Yeah, exactly. So when you are Markovian, D2 already saturates. D3 is equal to D2. There's no more information in 3 order correlation than in 2. All the information is contained in jumps when you are Markovian. When you are non-Markovian, you don't saturate in 2. So you get more irreversibility when you look at 3, D3, and more irreversibility if you get D4. And there could be a situation where you never saturate as well. This is the example I was giving now, actually. Here, when you here we are losing information because the full information is having x and y. When what we are doing here is irreversibility only with x. So information we have is smaller, and the resulting process is not second order or third order Markovian. It's even more. So we see D9 is almost saturating. This is, I think, D5 and D9. So with a very simple projecting this XY to X, we already get a non-Markovian process with higher order. And this you can do also in this example. In this example, if you group 2 states into 1, the resulting dynamics, I'm not sure if it would be third order Markovian. It's not clear to me. So just this type of Markov chains and these type of transformations generally do not just bring you to the next order of Markovianity, but brings you to higher order in general. Okay, That's a good question, actually. Other questions?
Any other question?
Excuse me, I have a question on the first part of this today lecture.
Yes.
It's possible to say that the A functional you introduced when you talk about frenzy is somewhat related to the Noether theorems and the generator of, yes, the Noether theorem.
I must say, I don't know. There is it's a good paper I can tell you about entropy production as a Noether invariant, which I can send you, but I don't think they look at it in this way. So I must say I'm not sure.
Okay, because the whole calculation you showed us, remember to me the. You know the calculation you do in field theory when you talk about the Noether theorem.
Mm-hmm.
But I remembered also that the energy is the Kodak generator of time translation.
Actually, you know that there is a PRX paper where they generalize the Harada-Sasa to field theories. So probably you are right, but I'm not sure how they do it mathematically. I have to go into the details of the paper. But it's a good point. I can send you a reference if you're interested.
Okay, thanks. I'd like.
Okay. I'll send it in the chat after the questions.
Thank you.
Okay, there's a question of Luca Sesta. Can you say the, can you connect your microphone and ask it?
Yeah, of course. So I was a bit confused or surprised by the fact that in the initial derivation of the Harada-Sasa equality, we had a response function that was not zero even if the time of the perturbation was previous to the time of the effect. And usually due to causality, you have not this this phenomenon. So
yeah, but in the end, when I take the limits, I assume causality when you take the limit. So you have to be careful on this. So in principle, I derive it, I put it rough, I put T minus S and they can be anything, but you must take into account when you do T minus S, T is greater than S, and when you do S minus T, S is greater than T. That's why later in my lecture, I put 0 plus and 0 minus. So it's you have to be a bit careful on this, but you're right. So in reality, there is no response from the future to the past. I recommend you to go to the paper because this is explaining more rigorously in the other proofs. The proof I gave you was the fastest, the quickest, but not the most rigorous. Okay, but this is a good point and it disappears.
Okay, so you take a different limit depending on the order of times.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. That's why it appears are 0 plus or 0 minus, and then the imaginary part. So be careful with this. It's a detail, but it's an important detail.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Other questions? If not, we can also close the session. We can discuss about the exam with PCS and diploma students.
I can create a room to discuss about that. So okay. I'll stop recording now.
Okay.